Welcome to the Music for the Soul podcast, where we talk honestly about difficult things. This is a place where music, hope, and healing come together. I'm Becky Nordquist.
And I'm Steve Seiler. We're so glad to have you with us today.
Well, I'm very excited to have you on the podcast today because we are going to be talking about a very special song. And we're also going to talk about a devotional that goes with it that I'm a little bit partial to. On today's podcast, we're going to talk about the song 23, taken directly from Psalm 23. It's one of the great timeless scriptures, and it's very special to me. I know it's special to you, Steve, and I'm sure some of our listeners as well. So could you tell us a little bit about how the song 23 came about?
Sure. Scott Krippayne and Tony Wood and I were in a prayer group together every Tuesday morning. It was really a lifeline for me when I first got to Nashville because I was new to the community. I was, you know, didn't have a church home at first. And being able to meet and pray regularly with people who were doing the same thing that I was doing, which is pursuing the songwriting career, was a very wonderful, supportive thing. And we were all dads, obviously all husbands. And it was just a really special time that we shared together. I had been writing songs for a company called Discovery House Music at that time. And the man who I worked with at DHM in Grand Rapids, Michigan, was named Brian Felton. And he wanted to do a music project based on a book called Fair Sunshine. And while that's a lovely, light, and airy title, the book was actually the story of the Scottish martyrs. So it was a profoundly bloody, disturbing book. It really, really was. And the stories that it shared were of miraculous testimonies of people standing for their faith against all odds. That led to a project called Celtic Cry. And Scott and Tony and I worked on that together. And we talked about what happened next in a recent interview with Scott Krippayne. So just going to play a snippet from that right now. We did get asked to do a record on the life of David. And Brian asked me to co-executive produce that project. And so I came back to you guys again and said, let's do this again, this model of the three of us. And one of the songs on that project is called 23. And when we were working on this, on this project, Tony is very good at organizing. And Tony and I got together in his office and he wanted to do post-its on the door frame. We'll do this moment and we'll do this moment and it'll go in this sort. It was this really great way to do it so you could visibly see it. And, you know, Tony being literally an award-winning lyricist made sense that he would be driving a lot of the lyric pieces. But when we got to talking about 23, it was like, we probably ought to go ahead and let David carry the lyric on Psalm 23.
He did all right there.
So our only assignment really was to choose the translation. And after we did that, you know, we said to Scott, here's the translation that we think we should use for 23. And Scott came back with a once in a generation or maybe several generations melody that became the highlight of that project. Not only that, the highlight of several future Music for the Soul projects. How did that melody come to you, Scott? Can you talk about that?
When I moved to Nashville, I was more of a melody guy. Melodies always came easier. And so I would get set up with lyric writers, you know, and you, Steve, do both really well. Tony was primarily a lyricist, you know, when I first met him. And so Tony would hand me lyrics that were done. And I would try to set them to music. So I'd had some experience just taking words on a page. The difference with a Psalm 23 is that it's not set up like in a verse, chorus, rhymey kind of thing.
Right.
So there's that challenge, but it's a Psalm that we know. It's a Psalm that brings up emotion for people. There's a lot of feeling in it. So if I'm sitting down to do that, it's kind of going, what do these words feel like? Do I hear something in my head? How does it emote? And then it's just making a choice going, it feels like this to me. What do y'all think? I think this feels like this to me. And sometimes it comes quickly. Sometimes it takes wrestling with, but I don't know. I hear things in my head, which, you know, sometimes can be a problem and sometimes can be a gift.
Well, that was certainly in the gift category. I recall you playing it for us, and it's like, yeah, that's done.
It's just really, so it's so beautiful. While I still agree with myself, it really is absolutely beautiful and so touching. So once the songs were done, how did the production come together?
Well, as we were writing the songs, we knew that we were going to have a strong cast of singers because that was Brian's vision for the project. And so we had people like Bob Carlisle, and this is post-Butterfly Kisses, Bob Carlisle. Greg Long, who most people know, not only from his solo career, but also from his time with Avalon. Clay Cross, Steve Camp, and of course, Scott Krippayne. So we were going to need an equally strong producer. And since I was co-executive producing the project, Brian asked me if I knew anyone that would be good to produce the recording. And I had been doing a ton of work on my demos and other recordings with Kent Hooper and recommended him for the job of producer. So you and I had the opportunity to speak with Kent and ask him how he decided on his vision for this song. Kent, when you were producing Ordinary Man, Extraordinary God, and it came time to work on 23, how did you decide the approach you were going to take to do the recording?
The most important decision I made on that track was to hire Phillip Keveren and then get out of the way. On other projects, I take a more active role as a producer. But when it came to that, I called Phillip and he said, I know what to do with this. And I said, okay. When we recorded the piano, I was pretty involved in coaching, I mean, not coaching Phillip, but I was involved in making sure it flowed the way I wanted to flow. I wanted to make sure the track moved along and didn't sit there and it wasn't too rubato. So I had definitely had input there. But once the piano was done, it was all Phillip until we got to the vocal side of things.
So had you worked with Phillip when you lived in California?
Phillip and I go further back than any person in my professional career. I was introduced to Phillip when I was at college. And while I was at college, my teacher had previously worked with Phillip and recommended me to Phillip to teach Phillip how to use computers and music, which is such a funny thing to say because it's like, That's the only way music's made, right? You know,
right,
but back then, which would have been 1992, I think, Phillip was using these outboard things called sequencers in order to make music. It was incredibly cumbersome. And at the time, you know, or when he first got it, it was revolutionary, but Phillip was still using it. It was, you know, it was like he was still using a rickshaw when cars were already invented. So I went down and spent a week with him and taught him how to use computer. I taught him how to use America Online, and we went to CompUSA and he bought his first computer. And that began kind of our friendship. And eventually, Phillip actually took me over to Yamaha where he was working and introduced me, which and got me a job at Yamaha. And then I moved to Nashville, and then I gave Phillip his first job in Nashville, and he followed me out here about 5 years after I moved out here. So that was a long-winded answer to say, yes, Phillip and I go way back.
Awesome.
So, Kent, where did you record the orchestra for the project?
I believe that we recorded the orchestra at Ocean Way Studios for that. And in Nashville, there's not, surprisingly, not many places to record a large orchestra. Even though we have arguably the biggest talent pool, I would argue, anywhere in the world, when it comes to huge studios, we have one, and it's Ocean Way. Mm-hmm. And so that's where we went.
What Incredible. I love about Ocean Way is that it used to be a church. And so when you're doing sacred music in that space, it just feels like God is a little closer. I know God's just as close no matter where you are, but there's just something about that setting that does create a wonderful, can I use the word vibe?
Yeah.
Sacred no, it does, vibe. It, do those yeah. things go together?
Sure. Yeah. They do today.
I think so. It is an incredible space. It's beautiful. And so does anything stand out about the experience of recording 23? Anything in particular?
Yeah, after we recorded the piano, I knew the piece of music was special, and we got a good piano track. But Phillip did not do a synth mock-up of the orchestra. Sometimes he does. Sometimes he'll actually, using samples, he'll program something up so I can get a sense of what things are going to sound like. And, you know, I can read a score and imagine, but there's still something special about hearing a mock-up that helps you decide things. We didn't do one on that. I just knew that Phillip, he had it. And he told me, I've got this. And I went, okay, I trust you. So hearing the score for the first time was special. And if I remember right, that song, we did not cut that song with a click. It's very normal these days. In fact, it's the standard that when you're recording something, you're going to record it to a click. Now, if there's a lot of rubato, that means you have to spend a lot of time on the click and programming and those tempo changes. And then when you get to recording date, it's all mapped out. We didn't do that for 23. Phillip's piano was the click. And wow. Since he played the piano and he wrote the score and he was the conductor, he knew exactly where to put everything, and everybody just follows him. And even though that's not the norm anymore, there's something really special about that, because when you're programming a click in, you're doing your best, but it's a very mathematical process. This wasn't. This was completely emotion, flow, feel. And when you've got the same person playing the piano, doing the score, and conducting, it just kind of all clicks. And the orchestra feels that. They know that. And they actually have to pay a little bit more attention when there's no click to the conductor, which means they're responding to his energy, to his emotion better. So even though we don't do that very much anymore, it is pretty special when you do get to do it, because the end result is typically quite a bit more moving.
So Kent, also known, and I love to call him the wizard, because he is a wizard at what he does. Kent mentioned hiring his friend, the amazing Phillip Keveren. And we spoke with PK on a previous podcast. And let's take a listen to that now.
Our good friend Kent Hooper, who was the producer on that session, invited me in and sat me down at the console and said, I want to play 23 for you. And I closed my eyes and bowed my head and listened and thought to myself as I was listening, if this is the only piece of music I ever get to be a part of in my entire career, it was worth it. That's truly how moved I was. And I know I didn't feel that way when we were working on the demo, so that a lot of that had to be from your arrangement.
Well, that's an important song to our family, because we were living in California at that time. And when I arranged that and came to Nashville to record it, that's when I fell in love with the Nashville music community. I had been in and out of here many times, but it was kind of a hit and miss thing. That day with that particular orchestra and this particular song, God spoke very clearly to me. This is a juncture for you. You're going to go in a little bit different direction. And we moved to Nashville within the next 9 months after that. There are certain arrangements, I'm sure you, Becky, and Steve as well, there are certain songs that you just know were given to you. And that sounds pompous, but truly, there are times when God just kind of touches that situation and gives you what you need in that moment. And you can't explain why it came out special.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah. that was one of them. I listen to that orchestration still in that song and I go, wow. You know, at the time I just wrote it and off we went and we did it. But honestly, that is a very special thing that happened there.
So you had never met or worked with Phillip before?
No, this was my first introduction to Phillip Keveren. And there's really a wonderful story about that and the way God works. After I'd heard the piece, I wanted to reach out and thank Phillip for the amazing work that he had done. So I got his phone number from Kent. And one evening I sat down and I called him. And I didn't know this at the time. I mean, he picked up the phone and I told him, hey, you know, I just wanted to call and thank you for how wonderful the strings on 23 are. The arrangement is absolutely gorgeous. And we chatted for a few minutes, you know, very surfacey because we didn't know each other. He thanked me, and that was pretty much it, or so I thought. What I hadn't known is that at the very moment that I called, Phillip and his wife were sitting on the couch out in California talking and trying to decide if they wanted to move to Nashville, Tennessee. And Phillip says that he hung up the phone and went back to the couch and sat down and told his wife, "We're supposed to move to Nashville."
Wow. Wow.
That my call actually prompted that thought. And of course, at that point, I had to thank my wife, because my Meredith had told me early on when I first started into the business, always write a thank you note. It doesn't take that much time. It's not that hard to do, but it's a way of showing people that you care about them and that you care about their work and that you're glad to have the opportunity to do the projects together. And so I can thank Meredith for the fact that Phillip Keveren moved to Nashville and has been the string arranger on like 25 Music for the Soul songs.
So anyway. Well, she's a wise woman, that Meredith. Yes, I happen to be a big fan of hers. Yes, so she's incredible. So thank you, Meredith. So how do you feel about, you know, you talked a little bit about how you felt when you first heard the mix and all of that stuff. How do you feel about it now?
I think one of the things that's really special about 23, about this recording, is how enduring it is. Usually when you write and produce something, record something, after a while, you've heard it a few times and you either like it or you don't. And actually, most of the time when you listen, you're like, oh, I wish I could do that over. You know, there's always something that you could do better. But I love this the first time I heard it. And to this day, even though I've heard it surely over 100 times, it can still move me to tears, bring me chills. I think that that's because we didn't change a word of scripture. I think it is the power of God's word coming alive through the music. Of course, music speaks to me as a songwriter and musician. So I think that's what does it. There is something, you mentioned the word timeless earlier when you were talking about the song. And I think obviously it's the scripture that makes it timeless. Mm-hmm. I think Kent's choice to do it with a live orchestra, you know, with, for lack of a better word, organic instruments, timeless instruments like violin and cello and French horn and all those things. And then to have a grand piano, I just think all of that combines to create a recording that's going to be just as powerful 50 years from now as it was when it was recorded.
Yes, it's such an incredible piece in that realm of you can just soak it in, if you will, and you are spot on. I think there's such power in the word of God that it really is timeless. It really is. And the power of that inspired word, it applies to every moment of life. And you all just captured this so incredibly. And it's a timeless scripture that even if people are not churched, or even people that have no history with religion or reading the Bible, it's a well-known scripture. So it really ministers with pretty broad stroke.
Yes. You know? I don't think I've ever been to a funeral where the 23rd Psalm wasn't included either as a reading or written in the program. It's always involved in those important life moments, in those passings. And I've found that to be true whether the funeral is a Christian funeral or not.
Absolutely.
So I think what you're saying about it having a broad application is very, very true. I think people have heard it so many times and in so many different places that it does have that feeling of the familiar that brings comfort.
Right. Right up there with Amazing Grace. You know, you have two songs if you need to write something in. So it was recorded for the David Project. I'm wondering, how did it wind up being on part of the Music for the Soul catalog?
Well, I have to give Brian Felton credit for being so gracious. Yes, it was part of the David record. That record was called Ordinary Man, Extraordinary God, and there were 10 or 12 songs all based on the life of David. And the record did well. It was a very meaningful project to be a part of. But as we've already talked about, the song felt so enduring to me that when Music for the Soul started recording projects, there were just several times when I thought, ooh, you know what would really be special would be to hear Psalm 23. So I reached out to Brian and I said, hey, is there any chance you would allow me, as the director of Music for the Soul, to license that recording and use it on a Music for the Soul project? And he did me one better. He sent me a gratis license to use that recording on any project at any time in perpetuity for the ministry. And that's kind of how the song has wound up on five of our projects.
Wow. That's pretty incredible. That
Very
really
special.
Is. So five different projects, and I think there's different versions of it, correct? Am I
yes.
right in thinking
yes.
that?
Yes. When the Katrina event happened and we were doing a recording called After the Storm for the hurricane survivors, remember the whole incident of Ward 9 being wiped out. And there was a lot of talk about the way the races were experiencing the hurricane differently. And I felt like it was very, very important that an African-American voice deliver that message of hope. And Larnell Harris, and he would probably be angry if I told this story, but I'm going to tell it anyway, because it was so beautiful what he did. He was touring at the time, and we were dealing with a pretty tight deadline because we were trying to get the record recorded and in New Orleans, thousands of copies in New Orleans by Thanksgiving. And the hurricane was like August 28th or something. So there was really no time at all. And Larnell was going to be off the road for one day. So, and he lives in Louisville. So he flies home. He's been out on the road. He gets in the car the next morning. He drives to Nashville, which is about a 4-hour drive, sings the song for us, gets back in his car and drives back home to Louisville so he can go back out on the road the next day.
Wow.
And charged us nothing.
Wow.
So you want to talk about gracious. You want to talk about a pro's pro. You want to talk about somebody who's got a heart the size of Texas or bigger, that he cared enough about ministering to the people who had been hurt by the hurricane to give that gift. And of course, his performance is astonishing. So that was fabulous.
He is just such a stellar vocalist anyway. Just, oh my goodness. And I know I have not met him, I'm going to say yet. But I've always been just incredibly blessed and at awe at the gift that God has given him. I have to say that I love hearing stories like that because it's not always like that. For some, it really is a career. For others, it really is a ministry. And that just speaks Jesus to me. And it is a sacrifice. People often don't understand the sacrifice it is to be on the road for these people and waking up in a new town every morning and stuff. So for him to do that and to do it for free just out of compassion and his calling is just, wow. Thank you, Larnell, if you're listening. Wow, what a beautiful
gentleman.
Yes, what a beautiful story. And so there's other artists that have recorded this as well, right?
Yeah, I'll mention one more Music for the Soul recording first, and that's Nita Whitaker, who she was the female voice on our Drink Deep project for Grief, where Scotty Krippayne sang the male vocals and Nita sang the female vocals. And so we did a very different version of 23 for her. It's her vocal. Mark Baldwin playing acoustic guitar. And then there's, I believe there's a cello on there. I know there's one other instrument of color, but it's very stripped down, very intimate, very quiet. Whereas the Scott and Larnell versions are, I would say, triumphant, moving, but very powerful, you know, in that way. So very different. And then the song wound up being recorded by Ronan Tynan, who was the man who came to fame shortly after 9/11, singing at the Yankee Stadium. And then Sheila Walsh, many of our listeners, I'm sure, know her from her ministry. She recorded it. There have been some choral arrangements that Phillip has done that are available as well. So several recordings, and I'm certainly hoping that others will record it as well. It's such an important message to be out there.
Mm-hmm, absolutely. So I have to know, because we get a lot of response about different projects here at Music for the Soul and how people are blessed and touched. And there's nothing like that encouragement to kind of fuel the fire to keep a nonprofit going. So I am going to fish right now because I want to hear, have you had some responses to the recordings and the project? I'd love to hear some of those, and maybe our listeners would too.
Well, all right. I have saved a few over the years that were kind of special to me, so thank you for asking. I'll just share three. We heard from a gentleman in Texas, and he said, I was despairing and having thoughts of suicide tonight, and I found 23 on the internet. Thank you for this beautiful song of comfort and hope. You can't ask for much more of an impact than that. Mm-hmm. This one therapist came up to us at a conference we were doing in Nashville, and she said, she held up the CD of 23. Mm-hmm. And she said, I listen to this every day on the way to work and every day on the way home from work. And she said, it's an air filter that cleanses my spirit.
I love that.
Isn't that great?
Oh, my goodness. How often when you're driving home from work, do you just need to like decompress? Or I love that, an air filter to get all the junk out from the day, or even to prepare you for the day. Because I don't know about you, but I've worked in some places that I was like, Lord Jesus, you're going to have to take over because somebody's going to get hurt if you don't. So I can say that would be a wonderful way to filter out those thoughts and feelings on your way into work or on the way home. You know, I mean, that's awesome. That's really great.
Well, I'll share just one more. The first time I heard 23, this woman writes, I almost fainted. It was as a four-year-old child while walking on the beach, reciting those words that I first met Jesus. It blesses me to have the words that have been the comfort of my life put to music. The music takes the words even deeper into my heart. I play it all the time and have shared it with many friends.
That's awesome.
So it takes us back. Oh. We were talking about that enduring quality, timeless quality of it, and that comfort that comes with the familiar. So she kind of affirms that with what she shared.
That's so great. Thanks for having story time for us, because I just love, you know, how one piece of music can touch so many different places in different people. And, you know, it's the same song, but for each of us, wherever we're walking and journeying, it can hit us in a different way. And some of us, it's life dependent. Like the first gentleman you shared, you know, that's part of my story. And so music can play such an incredible part in bringing life to us and then healing us as we walk this road. And just the promises of his presence through all of it is why I just love that song. So I have to ask, why did you decide to write a devotional based on 23?
Well, for all the reasons that you've already mentioned, I just felt like it would be an opportunity to invite some of the people who participated in the recording, or some of the other people that have ministered in partnership with us through the years, to share their stories about what inspired them from the 23rd Psalm. Mm-hmm. And it gave me an opportunity also to, I think sometimes when we're reciting things or reading things that we've seen hundreds of times, it can begin to feel routine. Mm-hmm. So to be able to approach it when I was writing the daily portion of the devotional, it was like, okay, I'm going to write a devotion based on each and every line of the psalm, really be able to sit with it and to sink into it and to not race past to whatever the next phrase is. And I found that to be a fascinating process, and it was a blessing to be able to do it. So one of the things that we wanted to do is make portions of this devotional available to our listeners free of charge. So we're going to give you a link. musicforthesoul.org/23devo. That's the numbers. So musicforthesoul.org/23devo. And we'll put that link in the show notes as well. So please take advantage of downloading that and enjoying some writings based on the 23rd Psalm.
So great. I'm so excited that it's going to be available. And I really hope that our listeners will take advantage of that. I know it is a blessing to me. It was wonderful to be a part of that devotional too. And I love the stories that are in there, the devotionals, and they're nice and quick. So I know busy moms, they kind of need that power boost that takes about 5 minutes or whatever. You get whatever you can, whenever you can get it sometimes, but it's really great for busy people too. And just thank you so much for writing that and putting that together for our listeners and for the world too.
You know what? I think as we go out today, we should play, since we talked about him so much, let's play the Larnell Harris version of the 23rd for folks. How about that?
That sounds great.
is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence.